on this hard-hitting episode of Mythbusters. Adam and Jamie feel the good vibrations as they investigate if the sweet spot on the tennis racket can really prevent tennis elbow. And the team tries to find the lazy man's way of improving your tennis game. They don't just tell the myths, they put them to the test.
So, Jamie, the myth this week is that hitting a tennis ball into a tennis racket at the sweet spot will reduce the chance of developing tennis elbow. This is because the vibrations which are transmitted from the racket to the elbow are minimized.
Yes. Now, we know that hitting a ball at the sweet spot theoretically reduces the vibrations through the racket. However, we need to somehow measure the vibration through the racket frame at various impact points to see if this is really true.
You know, Jamie, I think there could be some truth to this myth.
Lateral epicondylitis, otherwise known as tennis elbow, is a condition common in racket sports due to the repetitive stress put on the elbow. Professional tennis players hit thousands of shots over the course of their career, but can reducing the vibrations transmitted to the racket by hitting the ball in the right spot every time really ward off the dreaded elbow?
Unfortunately, we can't just pick up a tennis racket and start hitting things to get our dub.
That's right. There's no way for us to know if we're hitting the ball with the same force or in the same position on the racket each time. We'll need to build a model so that we can control the force and the position at which the ball impacts the racket. Afterwards, we'll also have to check that our model is accurate.
It seems like when you hit a tennis ball, the racket will be free at the top, but fixed at the bottom because your hand's holding the handle. So why don't we try modeling the tennis racket with a clamp on one end and leave it free on the other? Then we can compare our data from that model to the results of a normal hit.
Let's go do that.
In order to determine the vibrations in the racket after a normal hit, we use a strain gauge which outputs data wirelessly to the computer. We can see as we compress and release the racket, the strains are measured. By observing these oscillations, we can determine the natural frequency of the racket after a standard hit. We'll then compare this to our model in the clamp-free case, and we'll be able to see if there's correlation between our model and that of a normal hit. All right, Grant, using this rig that we just whipped up, let's have a look at that tennis motion. Give it a hit.
Nice shot, Grant. We got some good vibrations there.
The transient frequency calculated for the real shot was found to be around 140 Hz. This should match the transient frequency of the clamp-free model, which will confirm that the correct boundary conditions have been used.
So, Jamie, Grant's just tested the frequency of a tennis racket after a normal hit, but we need a model that we can compare it to. So, we'll have a clamped end here and a free end here, and we'll see if we get the same kind of frequencies. Before we test, though, you got your glasses?
Check.
Lab coat?
Check.
Let's drop some balls.
Cool. So I'm going to drop this ball from precisely this height so that we can measure the frequency of the tennis racket.
Sounds
good.
You
ready to roll?
And go.
So by looking at our model and our actual values taken from Grant, it is clear that we're just not getting the same values. They all seem to be out by a factor of around 10. I guess we're just going to have to rethink this one.
It looks like Adam and Jamie are in a stiff situation. Let's see how the balls are going in the build team's court.
Another thing that I reckon might affect how well a tennis player plays is his pants. You notice the pros always have those short shorts.
Sure,
I think that's for a reason. Maybe pants are too long, so they go for the short ones.
Yeah. More movement, more comfortable.
Sounds feasible to me. Let's check it out.
Yep.
Let's try long pants. I don't like these pants, so I'll try one more. I'm going shorts. Yeah. Alright, now I'm in something more comfy. Let's try a better surf. Mini. Keep hitting the net. These shorts just aren't short enough.
He's our esteemed tennis player, Novak Djokovic.
Yeah, short shorts are better, definitely.
So now we're in really short shorts. Let's see how this goes.
It was a huge one. Look at that. fist, anything can happen. Exactly.
In this question of elbow excitation, Adam and Jamie thought they'd be slamming aces, but it seems all they're doing is hitting the net.
Clearly our first attempt at a model is incorrect. If it were correct, then we'd see that the frequencies of vibration from the model match those of that from the normal hit. Maybe we need to rethink our model. Let's try a different set of boundary conditions and see how we go.
The natural frequency and mode shapes of a tennis racket are dependent on the boundary conditions, meaning that the way the racket is held or modeled affects what natural frequencies and mode shapes are present. The frequencies measured for the two cases are different, meaning that the boundary conditions for the model must be incorrect. This means that the human arm mustn't act as a fixed end, but another type of boundary condition. This equation relates natural frequency to the boundary conditions, however this only applies if only one frequency is present. This can be tested using a cross-power spectral density function, or CPSD. A cross-power spectral density function is used instead of a fast Fourier transform, as it will help smooth out some of the associated noise in the strain gauge. As we can see, only one natural frequency is present at approximately 140 Hz. This indicates that it's okay to use this theory.
Well, looking at the theory, we've got the frequency, which we got from Grant's test. We've got the mass per unit length, and the length itself, and also this constant, which depends on the boundary conditions, which we first thought was clamped free, but obviously that was wrong. Now we need to figure out what EI is.
Well, I think we can get that through a static deflection test.
So using the value of EI that we just determined, we've tried a variety of different end conditions, and it turns out that the free end condition gives us a frequency which closely matches Rob's natural hit frequency.
So clearly the human arm is not strong enough to be modelled as a fixed free situation. Maybe the hand just acts as a dampener, we should model it as free and see how it goes.
So what we need is a way of mounting this tennis racket so that it has free ends.
Why don't we mount it on strings? Because they have negligible stiffness.
And then we could control the impulse with a tennis ball attached to a string.
Okay, here's my idea.
Yep, that looks like free boundary conditions to me. So now, Jamie, we need to test the impact at different positions on the racket. And then from there, we'll be able to determine how the vibrations is related to the impact of the ball on the racket.
So the strain gauge, which is located right here, will measure the strain at various positions along the racket, feed that information to the computer, and then the computer will be able to tell us the frequency.
When we've got the frequencies, we should be able to figure out where the sweet spot is.
That's right. I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitations. I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitations. I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitations. I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me
Using CPSD on the free rig, the natural frequencies were found to be around 140 Hz, almost identical to what was measured from an actual shot. To be completely sure that the use of free boundary conditions was correct, Jamie created a finite element model of the racket frame. To get the correct stiffness of the frame, he manipulated material properties based on the geometry and the results of the static deflection test. This model produced a frequency of 124.9 Hz, which is very similar to the test data. He created a model of the racket frame only, because the strings themselves do not affect the vibrations transmitted to the hand. This is because string vibration is at a much higher frequency than the racket frame's fundamental frequency, and so the response for mode 1 is negligible. While Adam and Jamie crunch bulk data, let's see what the rest of the team has discovered about sweaty exercising men.
So the final thing we should look at today is the size of your biceps. It's been proven that possibly bigger biceps is
possibly bigger.
Possibly.
Makes sense.
How about we go take a look at it?
Let's go to the tennis tournament and hit our tennis balls. Let's go to the tennis tournament and hear the linesman's calls. Forehand, backhand, volley serve. You will need a lot of nerve.
Buddy, you're a boy, make a big noise. Playing in the street, gonna be a big man someday. You got mud on your face, you big disgrace. Kicking your can all over the place, singing we will,
what you got?
We will rock you. We will rock you.
Adam and Jamie have determined that a tennis racket responds to an impulse in free vibration, but will hitting the ball in a supposed sweet spot actually reduce the amplitude of the response?
This is a plot of vibrational amplitude with position on the head of the tennis racket. We see at different positions, different responses are found. At this point here, we see a marked decrease in the amplitude. This is because a node point exists near the center of the head of the tennis racket.
So this shows there is a point on the racket where if you impact it, you will see a large reduction in the amplitude of vibration. The tennis industry calls this the sweet spot.
You know, Jamie, it seems like we've confirmed this myth.
Yes, hitting the tennis ball in the sweet spot of the racket does seem to reduce the vibrations through the frame, which could work to prevent tennis elbow.
Yeah, good.